I'll try to be brief. Next Sunday, the fellowship committee is going to have another Sunday soup, and I'm going to try to do these the first Sunday of every month. So I have a sign-up sheet, so be thinking about what kind of soup you'd like to make. And there's bread here, and also we're going to ask this year that maybe some of you help with cleanup. We've been doing that an awful long time, and we'd like to start training a few people in that kitchen. So there's a section there for cleanup there, real important. So I'm going to pass this around today. And then also next Sunday, really important, the Let's Get Dressed Up Capital Campaign Committee is going to be making a progress announcement to tell you kind of where we are on that. And that, you know, is we're raising funds to paint our church and to begin repairing the windows on Fellowship Hall. So we're going to have a big announcement next week. We also today have had to reschedule our congregational meeting, and we're going to do that on February 9th. So that's really, really important that you be here. You know, we're a small congregation, and we have to have a quorum. So be here, because we will need you. And even if you're not members, it's pretty interesting to see how Presbyterians do business. They are very organized, so important for that. And I hope that's everything that I wanted to say.
Thank you.
We will have a video recording of these announcements following worship. We'll be playing on a continuous loop out in the narthex if you'd like to find out what's really going on. Is there anything else at the risk of going too far here? Okay. Would you please take your bulletins and turn in them? This is really a very clever device here. For shopping lists, well, see if you got this. Maybe it looks like my shopping list. But let's stand together, shall we? Find the call to worship, which is in the bulletin, is responsive.
I will praise you, O Lord, with my whole heart. I will be glad and rejoice in you.
I will sing praise to your name, Most High.
You are my God.
And I will praise you.
You are my God.
And I will exalt you.
I have trusted in your mercy.
My heart shall rejoice in your salvation.
I will praise the name of God with a song, and will magnify him with thanksgiving.
Shall we bow together in prayer? Lord, we give you thanks that this day we can enter into this place to sing your praise, to worship you without distraction. And we ask, Lord, that you would guide our time together, that you would allow your Spirit to surround this place and to free us from the busyness of this week, that we might hear your gentle voice to us, that we might be transformed by the work of your Spirit in our midst. For we seek to glorify you in our lives daily, and we offer them to you this morning. In Jesus' name, and all God's children together said,
Amen.
Amen. This morning we're going to do something that we haven't done in quite a while. We're going to sing around. If you would turn to number 420. Now this is totally simple. So we're gonna do this. We'll sing the first line through for you, and we'll do it twice, and then we'll have you sing when we'll do it around, because that's what it is. Here. So no.
Singing, Hallelujah, Hallelujah, Hallelujah.
Okay, I was going to have to like face each other, but the worship team folks said, that's not probably a good idea. But bear in mind that you guys are singing to that group over there, and this group over here is singing to that group over there, and all of us are singing to the Lord, okay? Jerry and I,
yeah, it's fair.
We're going to go over here, right? Oh, yeah. We got you guys. You can stay there. I'll go over here. Yeah, we'll do the echo. We'll do the echo. We're going to start it out. Okay. Go for it.
Ready? Come into his presence, singing. Come into his presence. Thank you.
So I'll be sandwiches.
Yeah. Toast. Oh, we got a French toast yesterday. Peanut butter. Yeah. Bread casseroles. Casseroles? How do you do that? You stack them up. Okay, very cool. I've heard that before. That's cool. Yeah. Yes. Well, you know something? We take for granted. It's pretty easy to have bread. Your mom goes to the store, your dad goes to the store, and you get bread that's around the house. And it's there all the time whenever you want it. Did you know that there are some people who don't have bread? There are some people, even in the story, who don't have enough food to get by. They really don't. And you know what happens? They go hungry sometimes. And one of the things the church is called to do is to feed and to provide clothing and do stuff like that. And I bet you didn't know this, but downstairs here, man, I would love to take you on a tour of this. But downstairs, we have about 150 of these things. And we have tons more in the freezer, and we have fruits and vegetables and cans and spaghetti sauce and pasta and fruits and all kinds of stuff down there. But anyway, that might be. I'm not sure what that is, but it might be. There's enough but everything else down there. So, but the thing is this, people can come to the church when they need food, and they can get a shopping cart down there and go around and get everything they need. Well, that's a bunch of bananas. I see. That's important. Okay, bananas. I didn't notice that. Thank you. Yes, we have bananas in there. Yeah. So this is one of the things that we do at the church. And you know, if you want to sometime, I'll bet if you were hanging around after church, hey Tom, after church, you can take the kids, just open the door and take them down there and show them the place. If they want to stay around. After church, Tom may take them down there and show you what the word group bank is. But we serve about 200 families a month out there, I think, or 180, 150 families a month. And it's quite something. So, but let's do this today. Let's pray for people in Astoria. I know there are everywhere else too, but we're not everywhere else in Astoria. Okay. Holy King, we thank you. Oh, let's pray. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord, that you provide so very much for us. It's so special. Thank you that you give us an opportunity, like with the Super Bowl Sunday and the other events that we have, to focus our attention not just on the wealth and the prosperity that we enjoy, but to focus our energy toward giving and sharing. We know how in the Old Testament you command the people when they made their sacrifices to go and take some of what they were bringing and give it to those who had nothing. And how all along you have called us to be sensitive to those who are. So help us, Lord, day by day, Lord, when we see someone who doesn't have lunch at school, we see someone who's going hungry to be able to share from all that we have received so graciously from you, Mom and Dad. We thank you. We praise you. Thank you for guiding us. In Jesus' name.
Let us silently confess our personal sins and shortcomings together. So let's join in the unison prayer assurance. Thank you, O Lord, for the grace that you poured out our hearts, and for the riches of life you bring to us day by day. The power of your love overwhelms us.
Jerry is going to be bringing down the microphone in the events, and we might be able to share together some of the needs that we know about in the congregation and some of the situations that as a community we want to lift up to the Lord. And also we want to rejoice together when God has done something marvelous in your life. Don't wait to share it till sometime when you want to roll it in the air. Go ahead and let us know so that we can rejoice with you, okay? And we invite you to do that this morning so that we can pray together and give each one up an encouragement. If you use this microphone that Jerry brings, don't be afraid of it. Then the people that are using the hearing assistance devices, and there are some, can hear and participate together with us, okay?
Any joys or concerns?
We have several types of new hearing device attachments for here and stuff back here now. So, any of you want to do the service a little better, or anything, they're in the back, and there's, like I said, I think there's three different types now. So, try them out if you want to hear yesterday's sermon.
Together more closely as a family. you would show us creatively how we can minister to those in our midst who are in need. That you would help us be tangible in our love and persistent in our care. We give you thanks, Lord, for the ways in which you touch our lives and make us whole. We give you thanks. That you would show us creatively how we can minister to those in our midst who are in need. That you would help us be tangible in our love and persistent in our care. We give you thanks, Lord, for the ways in which you touch our lives and make us whole. We give you thanks for Mark and Stephanie and for others who are recovering. We thank you that you care deeply for us. And so, please hear quietly the prayers of our hearts as we lift those to you in need. That we're not mentioned out loud this morning, but that we know in our own experience to need your touch, your compassion, your mercy. Pray for the many people of this congregation who are ill and those who are confined more to home than they are anywhere else, that you would be encouraging to them, that you would bring members of the body to visit with compassion and mercy. Give us listening ears, Lord, and hearts that bend to you. Lord, thank you for the family that Linda was able to enjoy. Thank you for the beauty of the day that we have this day and every day surrounding us that we so much take for granted. We pray, Lord, for those families that are separated by military service or ministries of compassion, for those who are far away from our land here who are serving. We pray for those you have raised up to lead us as a nation, to lead us as a church, to lead us as a community together. We ask your wisdom, your guidance, your heart for those people and groups. Strengthen us in our ministry and in our life together and as individuals seeking to follow you. For we commit ourselves to that ministry together in the words that Jesus taught us, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread. And forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. Now lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
Our scripture reading from today, the first one is first chapter of Jeremiah, verses 4 to 10. And you'll find it on page 647 in the Pew Bible. Now the word of the Lord came to me, saying, Before I formed you in the womb, I knew you. And before you were born, I consecrated you. I appointed you a prophet to the nations. Then I said, Ah, Lord, behold, I do not know how to speak, for I am only a youth. But the Lord said to me, Do not say, I am only a youth, for to all to whom I send you, you shall go. And whatever I command you, you shall speak. Be not afraid of them, for I am with you to deliver you, says the Lord. Then the Lord put forth his hand and touched my mouth, and the Lord said to me, Behold, I have put my words in your mouth. See, I have set you this day over nations and over kingdoms to pluck up and to break down, to destroy and to overthrow, to build and to plant. And our next one is the fourth chapter of Luke. We have verses 14 through 21, page 892. And Jesus returned in the power of the Spirit into Galilee, and a report concerning him went out to all the surrounding country. And he taught in their synagogues, being glorified by all. And he came to Nazareth, where he had been brought up, and he went to the synagogue, as his custom was, on the Sabbath day. And he stood up to read. And there was given to him the book of the prophet Isaiah. He opened the book and found the place where it was written, The Spirit of the Lord is upon me, because he has anointed me to preach good news to the poor. He has sent me to proclaim release to the captives, and recovering of sight to the blind, to set at liberty those who are oppressed, to proclaim the acceptable year of the Lord. And he closed the book and gave it back to the attendant and sat down. And the eyes of all in the synagogue were fixed on him. And he began to say to them, Today the scripture has been fulfilled in your hearing. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Thank you, Jerry, for that reading this morning. As we get into looking at the business of the church, what the church is really here for, and the lectionary reading this morning, in this several weeks now after Epiphany, after the revealing of Jesus, brings us to a place in the ministry of Jesus where he clearly identifies what the business of the church is, what his business is. Thank you. What his business is here among the people. We are told that this event is, of course, found in all three of the Synoptic Gospels, and it, of course, is a marking point for the beginning of the ministry of Jesus. He was well known. He had been going around and preaching in the countryside around Nazareth and Galilee, and had been well received. Miracles had been happening, healings had taken place, things had started to really go along, and he was known. And so he comes to his hometown, and he comes to the place where he had grown up, where everybody on the streets by now knew him. They would say, Isn't that Joseph's son? Isn't that Jesus, Joseph's son? They would know him and recognize him. And we do not know at this time where Joseph was, whether he was gone or not, but Jesus is very clearly identified with his mother, as we saw last week when he was at the wedding at Cana. There is this sense in which Jesus comes into the temple in a very usual way, in an expected way, and probably as the honored guest who was well recognized, he was selected to be given the reading. And he chose to read this.
this section from Isaiah. And he didn't read the whole thing. He just read a section of it. And then he sat down and he did what the rabbis would normally do, which is to begin the discussion. Only rather than beginning the discussion and asking some kind of question, he begins the discussion with a statement, which is really a very blunt statement, a statement which offers no additional clauses or invites no feedback. It simply says, "Today these words are fulfilled in your hearing." What was the reception? It weren't good. They wanted to get rid of it, and this is the very beginning of times that don't go well. There is a sense here where this event is a watershed moment for the ministry of Jesus and a beginning identification point for the church. It is a prophetic word which Jesus embraces as his own. He says, "The Spirit of the Lord is upon me," and there is a personal sense to the way in which he embraces that phrase. He is identifying himself with the messianic expectations which were readily there among the congregation. For in this period of time, prior to this period of time, there had been many uprisings, many so-called messiahs who had come to deliver the people from Rome, many revolts. If you want to read about them, you can read in 1st and 2nd Maccabees and other places in what we call the Apocrypha. And it is clear from Jesus that this is something new, and the response is, who is this person? It's annoyance. It's rejection. That is the response of the congregation to which he speaks. This event is a defining moment for who Jesus is. It is a defining moment for who the church is. For it speaks about the person of Christ, and it speaks about the ministry of the church. That good news that God desires to give is for what I have learned are called the at-risk people. Who are the at-risk people? Who are the at-risk people? Carol and I used to live in what we call, when we were first married, and when we were headed for Africa. Excuse me, I don't know where I have a frog that's just recently decided to become a polywater, something like that. Carol and I, when we were first married in seminary, we were headed for Africa, decided that we needed a cross-cultural experience. So we moved to Washington Boulevard in Pasadena, which is several blocks up from Colorado, by the way, actually. And Washington Boulevard was the borderline between NSP and Bloods. The Bloods were a black gang from the south side, and NSP was a north side Pasadena gang from the north side, I guess, the Hispanic group. And so the graffiti was everywhere, NSP and Bloods. I'd go to hit tennis balls in the park, and on the backboard, it was right there, Bloods. Really very inspiring for tennis. Okay. And so this was the place we lived. I remember, we both remember one night, waking up actually early hours of the morning and hearing a gunfire and kind of rolling out of bed as we kind of learned that was what we did in that part of the place where we were. And I heard shotgun pellets hitting our roof, you know, the bang. And in the morning I went out and found some 20-gauge shotgun shells on the corner of our house. Evidently somebody had used the corner of our house as shelter for cover for a drive-by. And we never heard anything more about it. It was like one of those things. But that was where we lived. It was a very good culturally enlightening experience. I'm not sure whether we were at risk or what, but I know for a fact that the people who were actively involved in this were at risk. They were at risk. Who is it that Jesus came to minister to. This word tells us about those who are blind, who are lame, who are blind, those who are in prison, those who are outcasts, those who live beyond the edges and fringes of society. We see this echoed in Jesus' commission to recover from a drive-by, and we never heard anything more about it. It was one of those things, but that was really good. It was a very good culturally enlightening experience. I'm not sure the reword risks or what, but I know for a fact that the people who were actively involved in this were at risk. They were at risk. Who is it that Jesus came to minister to? This word tells us about those who are blind, who are lame, who are blind, those who are in prison, those who are outcasts, those who live beyond the edges and fringes of society. We see this echoed in Jesus' commission of Peter, where he says to Peter, "You are Peter." After Peter says, you know, the confession of Peter. What is the confession of Peter? You remember that? What's the confession of Peter? Jesus says, "Who do you say that I am?" His disciples said, "But who do you say that I am?" The Son of the Living God. The Son of the Living God. Okay. And so Peter is identified. What does Jesus say? "I'm giving you the keys to the kingdom. Whatever you bind on earth, now on earth. This ministry of binding and loosing is the ministry of setting people free. It's the ministry that belongs to the church by the way of Peter, the ministry that is given to us when Jesus is talking about the ministry that the disciples carry on to the people. He says, "As you have done it to the least of these, so you have done it to me. You have fed the hungry, you have clothed those who were naked, you have visited those who are in prison." Those are the people who are at risk. And brothers and sisters, may I share with you, we are all at risk. We are all one step away, one doctor's visit away, one heartbeat away from being at risk. So we should have an affinity for the ministry that Jesus has called us to be a part of. I'm sharing this with you because, brothers and sisters, largely the American church in general has lost track of the business that Jesus established. You see, in contemporary society, contemporary church, we're very interested in singing the right songs. We're very interested in the PA system, and we're very interested in the display. We want sermons that sound good. We want things that are relevant to us. We want to be entertained because that's American culture. And so we focus on what I have come to call the 2% of the time when we are here. And we are thankful when Pastor Dave gives a good message, or Jerry sings something nice, or the group does something. We're loving the place where we are, with the stained glass and all that. So look, it's the 2% time, as I told you. The 98% time is where we are when we're not here, where Jesus calls us to be salt and light in this world of need. Jesus knows our tendency. Ministry to at-risk folks is hard, and it is expensive, and it is something that requires thought and creativity, and the Holy Spirit is absolutely essential. In Los Angeles, there is a man named Father Gregory Boyle. Father Gregory Boyle, this is from the Los Angeles Times, 25th of January. I believe that's today.
yesterday, Saturday Times, LA Times. He talks about a ministry there called Homeboy Industries. Homeboy Industries, isn't that cool? Still facing a daily struggle. For a quarter of a century, Boyle has served. He was a pastor at Dolores Church until he left that to become the director of this ministry. Boyle has steered boys and girls and men and women out of gang life through Homeboy Industries, which offers job training, counseling, tattoo removal, that's important, tattoo removal, and more. It's been replicated around the country and abroad. Here in Los Angeles, some 120,000 gang members have voluntarily asked Father Boyle for help starting over. They struggle daily against the social economic forces that drew them into gang life, but Homeboy itself confronts another daily struggle, making ends meet. Making ends meet. Our government funding has gone in the last 3 years from 20% of our annual $14 million budget to 3%, Boyle said to the police commissioners. I suspect that if we were a shelter for abandoned puppies, we'd be endowed by now.